गुड इवनिंग एवरीबॉडी। आई वेलकम ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स फॉर 9 डे नेशनल लेवल ऑनलाइन एफडीपी ऑन फोरग्राउंडिंग द कैरेक्टर मॉडर्न ह्यूमन लाइफ ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय Balaji Institute of Technology and Science, Laknepalli, Narsampet, Warangal. As a part of schedule, today we have a resource person, Dr. V. Sudhakar Rao Garu, working in our college since 2001 on a topic, Exploring Exceptions in English Grammar. I am so privileged to have Sir accepted our request for taking this session. Before to introduce resource person, I request the coordinator of this 9-day FDP, Mr. Ajam, to read the bio data of today's resource person, Professor V. Sudhakar Rao Garu. Over to Mr. Ajam.
Very good evening, all. It gives me an immense pleasure to introduce today's resource person, Dr. V. Sudhakar Rao sir, a ray of hope, sunshine, and a vibrant personality of our department. Dr. V. Sudhakar Rao sir has been rendering his services as an associate professor in the Department of English, Humanities and Science, Balaji Institute of Technology and Science for the last 19 years, that is, since its inception. He has a total of 30 years of teaching and research experience. Earlier, he worked as an associate professor in Aurora Group of Institutions and Kids Institutions. He obtained his master's degree and doctorate from JN2H in the specialization of ELT. He also obtained PGDTE from English and Foreign Languages University. He has been head of the department for 2 decades. He also held many academic and administrative responsibilities and also the coordinator for many committees. Dr. V. Sudhakar Rao sir has attended various workshops, conferences, and training programs. He has published and presented research papers in national and international journals and also has been a resource person for many FDPs and webinars. Today we have him again as a resource person for this 9-day FDP. We are pleased to have you, sir. Now I request sir to proceed the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jam. I would like to first express my gratitude to our management chairman, Dr. A. Rajendra Prasad Reddy Garu, secretary, Dr. G. Rajeshwar Reddy Garu, and our beloved principal, Dr. V. S. Hariharan Garu, and our head of the department, Dr. V. Narayan Garu, for their wholehearted encouragement for promoting all the academic activities like FDPs and seminars at our institute. I would also like to thank our colleague friends, Mrs. A. Karunasri and Mr. Ajam for their support in this particular endeavor. Now let me talk about the FDP, the title that is as mentioned by our head of the department and shown in the slide just now, Foregrounding the Spectrum of Character Building in Modern Human Life. And my topic is Exploring Exceptions in English Grammar. One of our resource persons for this FDP, Professor G. Damodar Garu, was asking one question. This is the title that you have placed is for about character spectrum of character building. And you are about to take up some topic on English grammar. How do you link up and how do you justify this? Then I was telling him that I am looking not only in terms of character building, I am just looking at that as a whole personality building. So as a good person, to have a good personality as a professional teacher, we need to communicate very effectively. So that brings a lot of difference in the grades that we have in the classes, right? So ability to speak correct English in the classes is part of our personality building as a part of our character too. So in that way, I have just linked. And we have all different domains that have been presented from different angles for this particular activity. So let me now go into my topic, that is exploring exceptions in English grammar. Again, just to try to show my, let me share the screen and then we'll talk about that. Yeah, this is the topic, exploring exceptions in English grammar. Why did I choose this particular one? Just 1 or 2 minutes on this and then we'll go into the topic, right? So exceptions, English grammar is such a big thing. It's like a big ocean. And it's like so many rules and regulations are there. And at the same time, so many exceptions are there. So if we learn all the exceptions along with the rules, then we can speak very effectively. But the problem is many of the, even not only students, even our faculty members too, had got some problem. So in these 30 years of experience, I have seen so many faculty members speaking some wrong sentences when the draft also something was going wrong and all that. So in view of that, you know, better I expose and focus in some areas which need some special attention. So that's the reason why I have chosen certain exceptions here, not all. I mean, we cannot cover all that, it cannot be exhaustive issue on exceptions, but a few where we normally commit some kind of the errors. So if the participants focus on those areas, which are normally committed mistakes in day-to-day, that's the reason why I have chosen this. And let me try to explain as far as my knowledge is concerned. At the same time, I don't claim all these the things original, and I have consulted some important grammar books, and I am grateful to those authors also for giving for mentioning such wonderful points in the grammar book. Right, so let me go into the first point without any more delay. So this is the one normally everybody in every class more or less starts with the articles. So there are a number of rules in the articles. Some exceptions are also there. So I'm sure many people know all the exceptions and all that. But at least to start with one simple exception, so I have taken up this particular one. That means the first, as we go through that sentence, he has gone to the college, university, hospital or prison. So in this particular thing, we have placed the definite article, the. Only when we have to assume that this the subject is outsider. If a person is an outsider, that means the person does not belong to college. He is neither a student, nor a faculty, nor principal, nor any, he does not belong to that college. So if he goes to that college to meet his brother or sister or somebody, then we say, he has gone to that college. So the main point that is given in the bracket means outsider of any concerned organization, maybe college or university, hospital, prison or anything for that matter. And if he is an insider, that means he is part and parcel of that particular one. Suppose I am a principal or I am attender or something like that, then I can say I have gone to college. That means every day I will be going into that particular thing. Even for a hospital, a patient becomes a part of the hospital. So he has to say, I have gone to hospital. It has to be mentioned only when the person is outsider of the organization. And now coming, I will be sparing only just less than half a minute on every slide so that I think I can cover some important portions without leaving any slide, right? Articles. The should be used with the times of the day and night when prepositions during and in precede them. So if these two prepositions like during and in, if they precede, that means if they come before the words like day or noon, then we have to mention this. So see the example here. On hot days, people generally sleep during the day. During the day. So because we have used the word preposition there, during, then we must use the definite article the. Similarly, he is likely to come to us in the afternoon. So afternoon is used there. So we have to use the preposition, definite article there. So these two are the important. And what are the other things? Now I will go into the next point, that what are the other prepositions where we should not use. So, but don't use the, that is definite article when prepositions at, this is something is coming up. At, by, after, and before. The moment you have these prepositions in the sentences, then don't use the definite article. Example sentence, at sunrise, he got up to realize that his friend was not there. So not at the sunrise. The moment we say the moment the sun, the word comes, many people, I have seen many people just immediately they say da, because sun, da should be used before the word sun. You think unique one. So like that, certain mind setup is there. So now you understand that at sunrise, at, because the word at is there, so don't use the definite article. Similarly, I'm likely to finish this assignment by noon, not by the noon. So in the afternoon, there we have used, but when we are using the word by, then it should be without the definite article, the. After night fell, he went to bed with sense of loss. Again, we are using this after. So any words like at, by, after, and before, if these prepositions occur in the sentences, then don't use the definite article along with it. So the main question is sometimes people, students ask, sir, if we put the there, what's wrong? What's the problem? At the sunrise, if we say, are the heavens going to fall? But that's not the question here. When we learn something like grammar, then we have to learn as grammar. When we are learning foreign language, we have to follow their rules. If they come and learn our national language, Hindi or our regional languages and all, so they have to normally follow our own. So we have to look at in that particular aspect that we have to learn it perfectly. And especially those, especially English teachers, those who are here in this particular program as participants, better, you try to make note down. And if you know it already, I hope most of you might be knowing. If you don't know, then better know that and try to make use of it very effectively. Now illness, I have just given some heading which is linked with this particular word, right? So names of the major illnesses, any major illness, any major disease like cancer or cholera, these kind of the things, then we should not use, don't use any article before the names of the disease. That's a rule, but we have some exceptions. Like, see the names which are mentioned here, like influenza, diabetes, or pneumonia, don't use. We should not use. But at the same time, if the disease names of the disease such as flu, measles, mumps, or plague, we have to say the flu, the measles, the mumps, and the plague. This is compulsory. At the same time, with regard to minor illnesses also, we need to make use of. This is, in many grammar book it is given, but sometimes we don't even follow. So because we don't feel like saying, I am having a headache. Because the moment we say a headache, then if a headache is very severe, then we may have to say two or three headaches, which we don't say it. So that's the reason why many people even, they deny to accept this particular rule, like a headache, a cold. A cold means, that is there. But if, though the severe cold or if it is more also, you can't say I have two or three colds, but a cold is there, a cough is there, a headache, body aches, any ache you can mention with this indefinite article. So this is the major point in this. So major diseases, don't use it. Some diseases mentioned here, exceptions are there, you use that. And for minor illnesses, use the indefinite article A compulsorily in the sentences. And next one is by car. This is all regarding the transportation things and all. By car, by bus. No, this is normally what we say. We teach the students also the same thing, that when you go by some vehicle, I mean, when you use some vehicle for the transportation, you will have to use the word by. So normally we say, I went there by car, by bus, by boat, by plane, by bicycle, ship. Even we use the word by road, rail, by air and by sea. These are very important, that any vehicle, any kind of the vehicle for the transportation, we must use the word by. It is a preposition. But when it is to be linked with the articles here, the main issue here, the exception is here, you can say, I went there in the car. In the car, that means the preposition is used in instead of by. The moment we are using the preposition in, so that between that noun and preposition, we have to use this definite article. In the car, in a taxi, on the train, sometimes in the train is also correct, because that is acceptable, because it is an enclosed thing in which we sit, and the ship, on the ship, because we sit on the ship, in the flight. So these kind of the things we have to. So instead of by, if you use a preposition like in or on, we must use the definite article in between. In car is wrong. I went there in car is wrong. In the car or in a car. And the second point mentioned here, it is by letter. Again, some of the information is sent by letter, by post, by mail, by phone. By phone also we use, right? So instead of by, if you use that over, then you have to write. By phone directly you can use, but if you are saying, I would like to send that information, I would talk by phone, okay, I would talk over the phone. The moment you are using over, then definite article has to be mentioned. Over the phone, on the radio, I want to listen to the news on the radio, right? So these are this is a small exception, that using by without any definite article. But the moment you are using like prepositions like in, on, over, then you must use the definite article. All this with regard to the transportation systems and the information, passing on the information. Right. So this is again, I have not covered too many exceptions from articles. Every rule from the article has got an exception. But I have just picked up something where most of the people are committing mistakes. That is only my idea, particular idea about this particular FDP session, right? So prepositions. Enter into the hall. I mean, here in the sense, not, I'm not only focusing totally on exceptions. Some major errors when what the people that they cover in the during their talk or during their script. So the such kind of the things are also taken. Sometimes some confused words which we normally use in our day-to-day life. So such kind of the things have also been picked up and, you know, incorporated in this particular session, right? Enter into the hall is a common way of saying this. So don't say just enter the hall. Return back, so return itself has got, come back is equal to return. So, but in spite of knowing that, though we say this particular thing, don't use back with return, still people use it. Casually it comes, you know, just like our, based on our mother tongue, pull is there. As a result, they say, he returned back from England. A back, that back comes automatically. So now better avoid that, and it's only return, or use come back. So resembles to, so he resembles to his father is a very common way of speaking, but he resembles his father, that's it. Or his face resembles his father's face, whatever you want to compare. So in that way you can use resemble, but avoid this, the prepositions that I have already striken up there with the bold letter. So do that. So similarly, these are the important exceptions. What are these? When we use the words like this, next, last, this, that. I have seen many faculty members also talking about these words in the class with prepositions on or in. How I will take a class on next Sunday. May majority of the faculty, this is a very casually they speak, announce the sentence, I am going to take a class on next Sunday. So without on, they feel like that, you know, it is something something missing. That's what they feel. But better, not better, don't use. I will wait for you next Sunday. right? He joined duties last Thursday, but we feel that we are missing something definitely, but let that feeling be there, but speak grammar correctly, right? This, we have a meeting this evening only, not in this evening, right? So, and even in the college issue, some circulars also, this kind of the sentences are normally seen. So in your colleges or in your places, when something happens like this, then you inform the people that during these words, I mean, when you use the words like next, last, this and that, no, don't use. So last sentence, do you remember on that day I presented a gift to you? I mean, very casually we inform, but on that day is wrong. That day I presented a gift to you. Okay. Next is some more prepositions. Yeah, the same similar kind of thing is happening here. One, every, each, some, any. So when you have this, again, don't use any prepositions of on or in especially, right? We will meet one day, not we will meet on one day. On every day, we will have English. So one, sorry, the one English class, right? On every day, wrong. Why I'm saying, reiterating, I'm emphatically saying that these are used wrongly by many faculty members during their announcements in the classes. And the circulars that they sent to the classes contain this kind of wrong sentences. Appear to be right. If we say we will meet on one day, it doesn't appear to be wrong, but it is grammatically, it is wrong. So we have to follow that. Each, on each Sunday, wrong. Some students will go to picnic on some days, wrong, someday. I will conduct surprise test on any day. At least this is better if you say, I will conduct surprise test any day is correct. If you even say, I will conduct surprise test on any day, to some extent it may be right, but there are some people, they say, they announced even, I have seen that. I will conduct a surprise test on next Wednesday. I mean, calling that as a surprise test, and again, they are giving the date. Sometimes even that kind of mistakes are also committed by our teaching community. I mean, it's not wrong with the people because, you know, I'm working in engineering college. So many faculty, all faculty are experts in their subjects. There's no doubt about it. But when it comes to the English grammar and the English way of speaking, so definitely there would be some kind of confusion. So, that is okay. It is acceptable from their side, from their angle, if you look into. But again, my formula is that when we speak English, we have to speak correct English, whatever the profession in which we are, right? So let's go into the next one. Until, till, this is also, these are normally used wrongly, right? So until and till, both are acceptable. Both are acceptable. Shops are open till or until 9 p.m. What is the difference? Sometimes this, I mean, the main problem is with the English teachers, others will be suddenly asking this kind of the questions. What is the difference if I say shops will be open till 9 p.m. or until 9 p.m.? What is the difference? This kind of some small issues will be asked and we have to answer them timely. Otherwise, we have to show our ignorance. Especially, this is my request to all the English teachers, be experts in English grammar and try to convey the information to the people who are in need. Right. So in formal language, until is preferred in the beginning of sentence. Right. When you are using in the beginning, use until. Any sentence, formal or informal, whatever it may be, the blind rule that we let us have it. So in the beginning of that, don't say till he met her. That is a wrong issue here. So until he met her, he had never thought seriously. But if the sentence is, if until is, has to be used in the middle, he had never thought seriously of life until he met her or till he met her. So in the middle of that, it's okay. But in the beginning of the sentence, we are supposed to use only until. This is in the formal language. Okay. So next major issue, despite and in spite of. So, I mean, many of the people, majority, use this particular one, right? Despite of in spite of. They are interchangeable, almost can be used in the similar context, right? So despite and in spite mean the same thing, and many English learners confuse them. After despite, we should never use of. So simple example are given here. They enjoyed the baseball game despite of, cut it off and say only despite the rain, and they enjoyed the baseball game in spite of the rain. That means though rain has been there, the people enjoyed the baseball. So when we want to describe with these two different compound prepositions, then use despite without of and in spite of. This is a very, very, very common mistake that I have observed. Everybody, I mean, many people say that it is near to my house. The temple, I'm talking about temple, where is that house? That house is near to my temple, near to my house, sir. Or my room is near to my college, sir. Like these people, unexpectedly, they use that to immediately after the word near, right? So near and close, when you want to use the word close, you have to use with the to. This is the rule, right? But the examples here, our house is near the beach, not near to the beach, that's wrong. And our house is close to the beach. Either use this or that, but don't place to immediately after the near. And some abbreviations, acronyms. This is again another major issue that happens. People ask doubts, especially English teachers, school teachers or college teachers, whoever it may be. And if we are unable to clarify, then it's not a good thing for us, right? So what are these AM and PM? And in number of these circulars and all that, we do see this kind of the thing. AM and PM. AM and PM, 9 AM, 3 PM, 10 AM or 5 PM, whatever it is. So before 12 o'clock, we use AM, and after that, from 12 onwards, we use PM. But the major mistakes that are committed is that some people write in capital letters, AM and PM. And some people even put the dots, full stops in between. A dot M, P dot M, and some say A dot M dot, P dot M dot. All these are wrong. Simply write only small letters and without full stops. Right? So the full stops have to be omitted. In the old English, it was acceptable, but in the modern English, now you have to omit that. Yeah, and again, the question with another some more abbreviations here, UNO, I will read quickly, United Nations Organization. And automatic teller machine, and then frequently asked question, BBC, FBI, Federal Bureau of Investigation. And when we pronounce this, you now be careful. When we pronounce this, we are saying UNO. We are saying not saying you know, right? That means in initialism, this particular type of abbreviation wherein we are pronouncing every letter individually, UNO, ATM, FAQ, like that, right? So such kind of system is called initialism, and all of them should be written only in capitals. That is one rule. And if an abbreviation is pronounced not with individual letters, but directly like a word, say for example, NATO, we are not saying NATO, we pronounce that as NATO, National Aeronautics, what is that, administration, SAIL. Steel Authority of India Limited, Bhabha Atomic Research Center, NATO is North Atlantic Treaty Organization, and NASA. All these NASA, we are saying NATO, that means we are pronouncing that as a word. So such words are called, such abbreviations are called acronyms. Again, acronyms need to be mentioned in capitals. And one more, again, the same rule has to be applied here, no dots. But number of places, number of applications from the students or even these people we see normally, these dots are placed between these abbreviations. Please don't place them. And there are always, we talk about these abbreviations in capitals only, but there are certain abbreviations which are even mentioned in the small letters, like radar, like laser, even UNICEF. Like a very lengthy one, light amplification of stimulated emission of radiation, laser beams. That's what we talk about. So they are used like a word. It is actually an abbreviation. So this kind of acronyms can be used in small letters. Now, next one. See, this is always coming on my way. UP and NIMBY. Perhaps you have heard about these kind of the things, right? So these are very normally used abbreviations in abroad in other countries, whereas we don't much use it. But in some cosmopolitan cities here, and where in some advanced learning institutes, students will normally they use that, right? So what are these new acronyms? UP. UP means young urban professional who leads fashionable life in society. So there are now many young people who would like to enjoy this particular one, and say the for them even certain changes are made in some cities for their happiness and all that. So even that abbreviation UP is now even converted into verb UPify. So nowadays in some cities, in order to get more money by the government, so they will start even pubs and clubs, etc. That is for such people. So UPifying of some area, that way also we can use it. And NIMBY is another new abbreviation, NIMBY. That means these are some people who don't want to have any particular development in that area. If in that area, if a dustbin suppose has to be placed there, a waste dump in the neighborhood or in his locality, they'll come out and say no. So they always try to be in type of backyard. That's the reason why we call such people as NIMBY. Even the syndrome is also there. This kind of attitude is called NIMBY syndrome. So better avoid and try to convince the people suffering from NIMBY syndrome, and try to be UPifying is okay, because people do get some kind of entertainment. Those who are eligible to do that, they can do it. And not only those abbreviations, some new, other kinds of the abbreviations are also there, which are called blends. So we read grammar book, but we don't concentrate on these kind of the items. That is the reason why I have picked up such items where a specific concentration is required. Blends and portmanteau words or blends. What are they? Brunch. So instead of having heavy, breakfast and then lunch, in between people are having heavy food. They skip lunch, so that kind of thing is called brunch. So the words are taken BRE from this, UNCH from that, added. So this kind of abbreviations. Oxbridge, right? That has taken from Cambridge, Oxford and Cambridge. Why these two universities, very famous universities in England? So no any other university can be compared with the standards of these two universities, Oxford and Cambridge. So if you study or if you follow the trends that are happening in Oxford and Cambridge, so we can say that, Oxbridge trends. That means both that such kind of thing is available in Oxford and also Cambridge, Oxbridge type of things. So smog and motel, motorist and hotel, and even nowadays, entertainment is added into the education. Education through entertainment, that is also happening. So these certain words are called blends. One more thing is added now to this. We know these things actually, but we should know. We know in the sense, we know fridge. Fridge means refrigerator, we know, that's to that extent. And actually that F-R-I-G-E, from that area, this word fridge has been taken. So it has clipped from that particular area. And lab is a short form or abbreviation. How has it been taken up? So it has been taken up from the laboratory, lab. Some public house, so only pub has been taken. So we see number of the pubs outside now for youth, for UP. For UPs, so many pubs are coming up in cosmopolitan and metropolitan cities, right? And memo is from memorandum of marks. Similarly, you have recap from recapitulation, dorm for dormitory, exam for examination, and photo from photograph. So like this, there are several clippings. So we have to just know the terminology that these are clippings and be aware of those clippings. Full stops and plurals. Right, let us go a bit fast. I am going fast now, right? So full stops are to be omitted. This is already discussed. UNOWHO and even these plurals of abbreviations, VIPs, MLAs, VIP capital and smallest. So don't write capital S for to write the plural, then that becomes VIPs. So it is only VIPs, so MLAs and PHPs. So this is how we have to write the plural forms of this, because this is for educationalists. I mean, for all faculty members, when they need to write anything, any applications and all that, so we have to mention this particular one. And next point is accommodation. Accommodation is a place that is to stay, everybody knows. And because we always use, you know, he has got an accommodation in so and so place. An accommodation casually comes through our mouth, so it is not an accommodation. That is wrong. We have to say only we will provide accommodation. That means accommodation doesn't have the word before that. And but in English, I mean US English, in American English, even accommodations, the plural is also added. Whereas here, I mean, several people have been given residence in several houses. They say accommodations are given. In American English, it is there. In British English, we don't have. And one more point, according to the Prime Minister's scheme will be implemented soon. This is a normal statement that everybody reads from the newspapers and all that. But the point here it is, avoid expression according to somebody's opinion. According to somebody's opinion is a wrong thing. Either say according to that fellow or say in his opinion it is like it. So according to opinion is somebody's opinion is a wrong the combination of the words grammatically, right? So see the last sentence, according to him curfew will be imposed, or in his opinion curfew will be either of this has to be used. And anno domini, that is ADBC, again commonly used abbreviations type of things. So anno domini, before Christ and after Christ, these are the things. AMPM, already I just talked about the things. So, and especially when we use AD can be used before and after. See the first line, the king was born AD 278 or 278 AD. So both places it is acceptable. Whereas BC, at the bottom you can see 6th century BC, that is before Christ. So 5th century AD. So you can use AD only before and after, but when the century is used, AD should be used only after that. And when you use BC, that should be used only after centuries or any other date. Whatever the date it is given, you have to use only. BC should be used only after, at the end. But there is a chance for using it before that with regard to AD. Right. Now, attributive and predicative adjectives. These are some important small things that we need to know. That is, say, for example, blue shirt, young friend. So when we are directly talking about the shirt, that is in blue color, right? So that blue is called attributive adjective. And when we say in the bottom, you can see the shirt is blue, in that kind of a sentence, we are indirectly talking about. So now this kind of adjective is called, in the second last sentence, that is predicative adjective. Why these attributive and predicative adjectives to be known? Now I will tell you in the next slide, right? So there are certain these attributive adjectives like mere, major, sheer, sole, like, you know, mere happiness or a major operation. These kind of the words that we normally use, sheer lack, that's what we use, right? But the problem here it is, a major operation is okay, but we can't say operation is major. There we have say blue shirt is blue is okay. But here, the major operation, once the, we are using, we can't say operation is major, and similarly, we can't say the failure is utter. So these kinds of, these are attributive adjectives. So we must know that we can't say that, we can't make use of the other kind of the thing with this mere and utter. That's what you have to know, right? And one small point about the pronunciation, aged. This has to be pronounced. I have taken up some several at random. I mean, you will be finding at random. This is not like a chain process one by one. If we are starting prepositions, things are going only about prepositions. It's not like that. At random, I have picked up the important areas where we need to pay attention and exceptions. That is the main issue, right? Aged is pronounced pronounced aged when it is predicative. So the girl is aged 16. So this is that word aged is here a predicative adjective. So that's why we have to say aged. But when we say it as a attribute adjective, I am helping my aged father. Right? I am helping my aged father. Then that aged is other adjective, attribute adjective. Then we have to use aged, aged. That a sound also, one more vowel sound should be there. And again, there's a lot of comparison between British English and American English. A lot of spelling differences are there. Words are different. Like, you know, we call elevator there, lift there, cookies here, biscuits there, sweets there, candies there. Like a lot of difference. So that is a big issue. I mean, it's a total big topic, the differences between American English and British English. Only one thing, only one word is given here for pronunciational differences that we say in British schedule, and in American English we call it as schedule. Next, agenda. This is again major problem with all the education institutions. We will be having all agenda. Is, you know, agendum, that is a plural. Agenda is a plural of agendum actually. We don't use agendum at all, and there are seven items on agenda like that. But in modern usage, agenda is often singular. Agenda is written, number of items in the agenda, and it has a plural form, agendas also nowadays. That is, people are using it. I mean, it has become, it has come into the even modern language, and we have forgotten agenda, right? So these two agendas of different meetings are almost same. Different agendas of different meeting. Agenda means some items to be discussed in a particular meeting. Now, another issue, aggravate, right? So aggravating means to make worse, to make something serious. Right? Insomnia will aggravate your restlessness. Insomnia means sleeplessness. So that kind of the thing will increase, will make it our restlessness more serious. Whereas it has got another meaning also. What is that? To annoy or irritating some. So the student's behavior aggravated the teacher. It's not that, that kind of more serious or worse. The meaning here, it is irritating. Silence is really aggravating. There's no object. It is, no object is used after the word aggravating here, right? So consider these two important meanings. Now, one or two points about subject verb agreement. So when it's commonly known to everybody, one of the, then we have to use a plural one. One of the girls is. Then after that, after the girls, we have to use singular verb. That is known to everybody. But more than one, there is a phrase that is used again. If that is used, you have to use a singular subject, singular noun and singular verb. More than one boy is absent in the class. The moment we use the word more than, then automatically many people say that boys or girls and things like that. So this is the kind of the thing that you need to understand. More than one boy is absent. And another rule, lots of the rest of these things have to be used in the plural. Only point here you have to, I'm not describing in detail as the time is running out. So here the point is, whether you use lot of or lots of and all that, after that, what is this? You have given in the bold, people, items, pomegranates. You see this, whatever is used after this lot of or lots. If that is plural, then go for plural verb only. If that is singular, go for singular. Now we will see the singulars also. A lot of money, this is an uncountable noun, singular, so has been wasted. So because in the beginning itself, a lot of the moment the people read about that word, lot of, they go for many in the mind. They feel that is many, lots of information, but still you are using only is. Lots is there, but you are using only is because information is a singular one. So whatever is written, the singular or plural noun after the countable or uncountable, that also you see. After this, so based on that, you can use the singular or plural verb. A majority is another problem. Majority of the students, should we say are going or is going? This is again a doubt many people asked me also. So you have now, the point is the same kind of the thing. The majority or minority is followed by plural noun, takes a plural or singular. Both are correct. If you say majority of the politicians favors or favor repolling, the majority of the students are uninterested or the majority of the students is interested. Both are grammatically correct, acceptable. So like that, we have it, right? Similarly, none of the information, none of the is another phrase where we get major issues. So none of the information was reliable. Money has been saved. See the second line. So depending upon the noun that we are using, countable or not, so singular or plural, based on that you have to use. So not don't concentrate much on this the front part of that, like majority or lots of or none of. Ultimately, whatever the verb, whatever the noun that you are using immediately after that, that is more important for us. Based on that only use the verb. And same here, none of the followed by plural. If you have plural, then you can use singular or plural, both. None of the boys is hardworking is also acceptable. None of the boys are hardworking. That means in our mind, nobody, not all the boys are working. So then we use are. None of the boys, out of all these boys, not a single boy is hardworking. Then use is. Depending upon the situation, you can use both the things. And here the problem is very easy to remember, a number of. The moment we say a, then we feel that, you know, it is like a singular thing and all. But it should be followed with plural subject only and take a plural verb. Like a number of people grow. That means you see the sentence starts with a, then go for plural verb. And when you go for, when you go with the number of volunteers, anytime using a number, sentence you are starting with a number, go for plural verb. And if you start with the number, go for this verb. I mean, singular verb. These are the examples. And in abbreviations also sometimes like the country's GDP, after that should be used singular verb or plural verb. So this is gross domestic product, only singular. So even if we in that abbreviation, if we know the full form, based on the full form, we can find out whether it is singular or plural. You see, another abbreviation here, HNS. What is the full form of that? Hazardous and noxious substances, right? If that is used, then use R. That means abbreviation is abbreviation. If you expand it, if it is singular, you go for singular verb. If it is plural, go for plural. So we have to know the expansion of that particular. And here, again, many people do some mistakes here. What sort of the things? An aircraft is missing, but we say five aircrafts are missing, right? So, but here, these aircraft, deer or sheep, such kind of nouns don't have plural form. Both in plural and singular, they are same. So you have to say here, five aircraft were missing, not five aircrafts, as many people commit mistakes. Similarly, a few deers, a few sheep are grazing is a wrong thing, right? So you cannot even do that. A few deer or a few sheep. And these nouns like people, police, cattle are singular. Many people have come. Police have come. This is a big doubt for many whether we should use police for singular. If a policeman, if you are talking about a policeman, use has. But if you are talking about police as a word, as a noun, then go for plural only. They are appear to be singular, but they have to be used only in plural, right? But and same is the case with the people. You cannot have the word peoples, but here there is an exception. This custom is common to all African peoples. What is the rule? When we refer to the nations or some ethnic groups, then we can say this particular one. And with regard to quantity, dozens, we do two dozens, three dozens X, bring two dozens X is a wrong thing, two dozen X. So when you mention some number, numerals here, so don't go for plural. I think a number of times when we write checks in the, for the banks, on that we write 5,000 rupees, 5,000 only, that's wrong, right? 2 lakhs only, that's what people write it. 200 only. So don't mention when the mention number is mentioned here, don't go for plural form there. 2 dozen, 5,000, like that only. But only when some dozens of, if you bring an expression of there, you can use 2 dozens of apples were brought. it's okay. But 2 dozen apples were brought. I think you know now the difference between these usage of these two, right? In-laws, this is a compound noun when we form mother-in-law, father-in-law, brother-in-law like this, right? So when we have to make plurals, then S should not be there at the end. Mother-in-laws or daughter-in-laws is wrong. Daughters-in-law, this is a common rule everybody knows. The change is, the exception is, when because the mother is a noun, brother is a noun, right? Whereas here we are last bottom, you see grown-ups. So grown is like an adjective. So it's not direct noun there. So in such a certain compound word, if noun is not there, then go for the yes at the end, grown-ups or higher-ups. Avail, right? Avail usually occurs, I avail myself. I avail something. I mean, you cannot say, I want to avail my vacation. This is again with many faculty members who write this kind of the thing, avail vacation and leave or something. I avail myself or himself, this kind of the thing compulsory. You have to put the self word after the word avail. Awful means very bad, like awesome is good, awful is bad, right? But at the same time, awfully means extremely. I am awfully busy means there is nothing wrong, nothing bad with me. The word awfully, so this is as if the people use it, they use it wrongly because they know awful means bad. So similarly, they use the word, I did the thing something awfully. That's wrong. So that means extremely, meaning difference is there. And bath, these are the things. Bath means bathtubs. So the house has 2 baths, means 2 bathrooms or tubs are there. But bath means also, there's a one meaning like to have a bath, right? But when it comes to, I take a hot bath, you can use it like this kind of thing. You can use that as also verb, bathing. I mean, she baths everybody or she baths her baby. So in that way you can use it that. So we normally, I have seen many in the many families when they talk even in English with regard to bathing. So they don't use she bath her baby, baths her baby. So that kind of word is not used. Now you should understand it can be used as a verb also. And bath is also there, right? So bath means not bath, taking bath. Here it is soak in water. So you have to soak something in the water, you have to bath it. You must bath the wound, not bath, sorry, bath. The pronunciation is bath. However, again, there is exception in some people, American English. In American English, again, bath means bathing. So some kind of the confusion, but you be clear that in American English, it bath. And he has been to Delhi. He has been to some place. We use it. Has been means he has gone and come back. That is a clear version. But he has gone to Delhi. If you use that word, he has gone, then it means he may be in Delhi or he may be reaching Delhi now. From here he has already, but he has been to some place. The meaning of that particular thing is gone and come back. On behalf of that we use, we follow the British English, but in American English, we have in behalf of. So if any American, if comes as a chief guest to your college function and by chance, now if he talks about that in behalf of this thing, so don't feel that it's wrong. In American English, it is in behalf of one. And burn, this is of course simple one, burned, burn, burnt, which one to be used? Always there's a lot of confusion here. In American English, ED is used. But when we use this as an adjective, like partially burnt bodies, we don't say burned bodies, burnt bodies. So we have all the forms like dream, dreamt, learn, learnt. So these forms should be used when we use them in the adjective position. Weather and climate, people misuse totally. I mean, this is only confused words are there. So to clarify, weather is a particular day or 1 or 2 days, whatever atmospheric conditions are there, we call that as weather, cool weather, warm weather, etc. But in climate, we say this for a week days, for 1 month, for 6 months, if it is cool, then we say that time that thing is called climate. But there is an exception here. Climate can also be used as an attitude or opinions. The climate of public opinion is against the ruling party. So, like that. cloth is a piece of it is a piece which is knit or woven and then that is cloth, and we can also use that as countable, a dust cloth, dish cloth. There you can use the number of things, two dish cloths, one table cloth was purchased, like that you can use. But clothes, ready made dresses, when it comes to cloth only, that unstitched one, and here it is stitched one clothes. His clothes are new, but when you mention clothes, don't mention the number, please. This is a clear exception here. I have bought two new clothes is a wrong statement. I have bought some clothes only. Numbers cannot be given, should not be given the word before the word clothes, and even clothing word is also used for the word clothes, because in Kashmir you need warm clothing, means warm clothes are required there. Concerned. Concerned is again a major issue in our offices, in our colleges. We say I want to meet the concerned person. Concerned person is wrong. We have to say the person concerned, right? So you can't get an application form now because the clerk concerned is on you, not the concerned clerk is available. This is in this way many people use it. That's why I am trying to concentrate on this, right? And consider. Okay, I will just skip this. Any important ones, if at all there is damage, don't have plural, but here damages, the word can be used when the money has to be claimed. Otherwise, extensive damage is done only singular, but when the amount has to be paid to somebody as a compensation, we use that one, right? Data, again, we use in the files when writing, I want the data. So data has to be used in singular, and in these data, and then we use it as a plural, right? So this is a form, plural form of the word datum, as mentioned in the top. So, but we are not using it, right? Okay, this skip it. Deny. As the time is 5:56, I think I should stop now. Looking for any other important issue. Just to go through this, I will be doing, because I have kept many ready for you, but as time is running out, you just have double passives, like a meeting is proposed to be held tomorrow, should not be used. It is proposed to hold a meeting tomorrow, right? Like that, you can use it. Always, this is again major issue. I enjoyed is a wrong thing. You enjoy something. Object, this is a transitive verb. You have to say, I enjoyed a party, I enjoyed a function, or I enjoyed watching TV, or I enjoyed myself. Some object should be there after enjoy, otherwise just don't do it, right? Floor, this is another issue. In first floor in American English, and ground floor in the British English. So ground level, street level floor is called first floor in America and ground floor in British. After ground floor, we will have first floor, second floor in British. And again, don't say I am living in a floor. Maybe you are in India, but in any floor, if you want to refer to, don't say that I am living in a floor. You have to live on a floor. Right, this is a common one known to everybody. And again, okay word is from all correct. You can even use it as a verb. He okayed, the principal okayed the staff council, and as a noun also you can use, we have got okay from principal, right? And the last, we have come to the now end of this. Respected sir is a old fashioned term. Most of the times we normally say in the functions when we are asked to talk, respected sir, we should be better not to say this. Is no native speaker like in US or British English people, so they don't say that sir itself. The word sir has got itself the respect in that, so better not to write. You see in the bottom, students, when they write letters to us, R by sir, that is the respect that they give to us. Even they don't want to write full word also, like respected, R by sir is being written. Right, with this I have come to the end. I'm thankful to these writers and these books to acknowledge that I have used these things for this. So thank you very much. Almost on the dot. Just a few slides have to be skipped quickly, but I hope I have covered everything. If anything, anything to be asked, you welcome, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your elaboration. Sir, here is a few questions raised by many participants. Now, the first question is, can't we speak English without basics of grammar? I always believe spoken English is difficult by using grammar. This is a question from Manoj Tiwari.
Of course, as I told in the very beginning of the talk, that when we are learning a language, we have to learn all the rules and regulations of that language. And as English is spoken elsewhere throughout the world, then and it is becoming a mandatory course everywhere. So we have to speak grammar. We have to speak English with proper grammar. Now, though it is happening now elsewhere, even those students from English medium schools are also speaking wrong English. I have seen one student was saying he can't be able to do it. An English medium student, and he was talking very fluently, very confidently, was saying he can't be able to do it. So can't be and be able to, both are same, only one has to be used. So like that, things are going on. As it is a foreign language, let the things go on. But as far as possible, better to go for perfection. Thank you.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. The next question is, Sanjay Sahu, his question is, while speaking English, which one needs to focus, whether fluency or accuracy?
I feel that it is an accuracy, because once you have that accuracy, and then that leads to confidence levels, and if the confidence levels are high, the fluency automatically comes into picture. But with a lot of fluency, if one comes lot of mistakes, then people find faults with it. So we have to prefer the accuracy rather than that fluency.
Thank you, sir. The next question is Anil Kumar Sharma. His question is, there are many differences in British English as well as American English. How can we bridge a gap between American and British English?
Yeah, actually, we have been doing that. As you know, as Indians, we have liberty and we have a lot of opportunity to use either of these. So wherever it is comfortable to us, we are using. Say, for example, in British, they say you are sincerely at the end of the letter when they mention some dear sir or something. And Americans use yours truly at the end of MSC, at this leave taking. But we Indians, we have an opportunity, anything, either truly or sincerely. So as English is not directly our mother tongue or our language, so we have an opportunity to use this. So there's nothing like bridging the gap. So when you follow America, and if you want to stay in America, then follow that language. 90% of that are same, only 10% differences are there. And you try to learn the things and follow accordingly.
Here is the last question from Mr. Praveen Kumar. His question is, what are the recent changes in English language? And as a teacher of English, how can we update all the things?
Yeah, recent language is ever growing subject. Like every day, some new words will be added, new concepts are added, new terminology added. So things are going on. So as they do that, and of course, we cannot just depend upon the newspaper items, news in the items that are exhibited in the newspaper, that we cannot take it for granted. So they will be in running in the society. But when we really want to learn something seriously, then we have to definitely go into the through grammar books and then take them that only, as a real one. So in that way, we have to improve. And English teachers have to update in the sense, let them use all the modern equipment, modern issues like online classes and all that. Then they have to even watch TV news channels, wonderful TV news channels with a lot of debates and all that. Example like a Mirror TV, English. So the debates are really wonderful. If you sit for half an hour and listen to that, definitely you are going to update yourselves with the terminology and the structures also. So it is that our efforts, our interest. So if the English faculty have got real interest in learning English, so nobody stops it. And all things are available in the internet. So as the Reliance person has said, the duniya teri mutthi mein, it is in our hand in the mobile. So wherever you may be there, even by traveling the buses also, you can just open any doubts and just no English teacher is required. Nobody else is required. Just Google is the best teacher now, you can go into that and search for that and get the things. Only thing is, all these such kind of learned things should be put into the practice. And English teachers, especially in India, in the school level, they are not paying much attention towards pronunciation and grammar part of that. As a result, these grown-ups in our college, by the time they come to the college level and all that, then we have to face many problems in imparting the things and all. So I request school level teachers working in the schools, please pay more attention in giving the phonetics, grammar issues, and the English as a whole in a proper way. So that makes our, that reduces our tensions and our problems. Right, thank you.
Thank you, sir. Actually, as a teacher of English, we believe that we used to tell the students to get command on language, grammar, because grammar adds glamour to the life. Grammar adds some beautiness to the language. Really, sir?
There, I mean, grammar, if you speak correct English with correct grammar, there will be a glow on the face.
Yes.
So that is the glamour. I mean, the confidence levels will, then they are very high. Then definitely you look smart and handsome. So that adds value, definitely.
Yes. I do agree with you, sir. Learning grammar adds some beautiness to the language. Of course. Thank you, sir. Thank you for your nice elaboration, explanation with the help of PPT, sir. Thank you. I hope today's session, most of the English teachers in this session, they enjoyed and they came to know many things through your PPT, sir. Thank you. I extend my deep sense of gratitude to Dr. Sudhakar Rao, sir, for sparing your valuable time. Thank you, sir.
Okay, sir. Sir, I have two questions.
Okay, please.
Sir, you mentioned even till today, whenever I write any letter to the principal, I normally mention respected sir. I learned from the beginning. You said that is a old way of writing. R by sir. I never see such a pattern using by faculty or anybody, sir. R by sir, is it the formal way of giving respect to the hierarchy? That is my question.
No, I didn't say that faculty have used that. I said that students have used it. So okay. When I was HOD, I used to receive number of applications from the students. So the students write all these. So a lot of mistakes are found in the things. So that is a different issue. But this R by sir, I have found from them on their letters only. Okay. Then I was asking, what is this R by sir? Then they said, you know, it is respected sir. Then I was asking, no, is this respect that you are giving? You are not even writing that letter completely, that word completely respected. Because they are short forms, you know, these students are so habituated to use this short
shortcuts.
Form. WhatsApp messages and all that. I see, I and C only. I think you know this kind of.
HRU, how are you?
This is totally distorting the English language. So I request again, everybody, don't get accustomed to or addicted to that kind of the short forms of writing through WhatsApp. Otherwise, no, your English totally will be damaged. It will be totally crushed. So that's what, tarnished. So please request, this is a special request for everybody to use complete sentences, full length words.
Okay, right. Sir. And one more thing, sir, I learned today. You mentioned our house is near to the beach.
Yeah.
Our house is near the beach. As I'm located nearby A to Z medical shop, can I use my house is near to the A to Z medical shop or near?
No. My house is near A to Z medical shop. There is no no preposition to be used. Near itself means it is almost in that particular place. So near to is wrong. Only close to. My house is close to that place. Like that, suppose you are waiting at some place, temple. So I am waiting near a temple. You can say I'm standing close to the temple. You can come and find. That way you can see.
Thank you very much, sir. Today you delivered a wonderful talk, exploring exceptions in English grammar. I observed in my 15 years of service in this college, many faculty, of course, I'm a mathematics faculty. Now I tell you one incident. Many times when I commit any mistake, sir is the one. Today's resource person is my guru in this college. whenever I commit any mistake, sir is the one always corrects me. He is the right person. I'm happy. Today, most of the participants, they felt very happy and given wonderful feedback. Now, this is the time for day 6 feedback. Hope all the participants are ready. Okay, now I'll post today's feedback in your chat box. Be ready. Right. Now, just now I have posted. You can see. Day 6 feedback. I thank Dr. V. Sudhakar Rao Garu for your nice and deliberated lecture on English grammar. I learned many things, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Okay, now coming to tomorrow. Tomorrow's session is, tomorrow is day 7. The topic is... Tomorrow's topic is... Sister B.K. Vasanta Brahmakumaris, motivational speaker and meditation trainer. The topic is on mind power for excellence. So this is tomorrow, that is day 7. Once again, I thank today's resource person, Professor V. Sudhakar Rao Garu, for your nice and good lecture on English grammar. Now, this is the time to conclude today's session. I request Mr. Rajam, you please give a vote of thanks and conclude the session. Over to Mr. Rajam.
A very good evening to all. First of all, I would like to thank the management, Balaji Group of Institutions, for organizing this wonderful lecture. I also thank today's resource person, Dr. V.S. Sudhakar Rao, sir, for nice and wonderful talk, sir. And I also thank all the heads of the department and my dear teaching fraternity. I extend my inner gratitude. I thank all the participants for your valuable cooperation and enthusiasm for this session. I thank once again. Thank you all.
Yes, sir.
Now the session is going to end.
That's all for today. We'll close the meeting. Thank you, everybody.